Welcome. So today we're going to talk about analyzing data and discovering what actually lies within that data and some different approaches on when we have data that we're just first interrogating, what are some techniques or methods to figure out what is the appropriate analysis that makes some sense. So before we begin, we always have to understand that when we query some data and we want to get some answers out of it, we do have to understand any patterns or anything of that data ahead of time. It's always like these little DIBA cartoons. So he says, boss says, use the CRS data based on the size, based to size the market. And of course, Dilbert says, that data is wrong. He says, then use the SIBS database. He said, that data is also wrong. Can we average them? Sure, I can multiply them too. So this kind of is the old axiom of garbage in, garbage out. Make sure that why we discussed how data collection was so important and doing that properly, that then once you have that data, now we're trying to figure out what is it telling us. And so the method on how we go about approaching that matters as well, because different types of data patterns or different types of data structures or distributions give us different sense of how we need to approach whatever the questions that we want to ask of this data. So we're going to really look at three fundamental approaches. Exploratory data analysis, classical stats, which that's probably what most people are familiar with, and Bayesian analysis in this course. Now, Bayesian analysis for, on a deeper level, we're going to go in its own because it's a little bit different type of approach. This is where we're using a model and prior knowledge expertise to be able to look at data and be able to glean some information out of it and get higher confidence in what we know. Classical stats, most of us have been using this oftentimes, but you have to make sure that you have the fundamental assumptions valid before you can actually use classical statistics. And that's where sometimes people push that edge a little bit on understanding that. So it really comes before any of this, and this is going to be the bulk of the conversation today, is exploratory data analysis. And this is really the process of understanding what is the pattern of the data? What type of analysis is appropriate? Can we use classical statistical analysis, or do we have to use some other methodologies and maybe employ a statistician for very specific types of analyses? All those things matter when you're actually trying to understand how we can approach data appropriately and be able to glean true knowledge from it, true meaning from it, versus we're applying an analysis that is inappropriate for a data set. That's something you got to be careful of, because then in that sense, you would actually be using analyses to come up with a conclusion that's not necessarily true. So this is why it's so important to understand when you can and cannot use certain methods. So let's dive into exploratory data analysis a little bit. Now, if you notice here, we're actually looking at a little bit of the differences and sequences of what happens in these methodologies. Now, this is actually pulled from the National Institute of Standards website. So I've got the link down there if you really want to take a deep dive into this as to where this comes from. But they really have a little bit different order in which they're looking at what they want and what's coming out of the data. So all of them start with a problem. Obviously, we wouldn't be even collecting data if we didn't have a problem that we wanted to learn something about. They both collect data. This is where they diverge then. So exploratory data analysis, the first thing we do is we're not going to assume a model first. That's kind of one of the things you got to be careful of. We're going to analyze the data first to figure out what type of model may be appropriate. Then we can go from that model that we create to some conclusions and some type of decision making. Classical stats oftentimes jumps to the model and then we analyze the model to make conclusions. So that's a little bit different. And I implore you to always, 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 if it's data you have no familiarity with at all, do an exploratory data analysis first, because that will let you know that, yes, I can use classical statistics because I passed some tests, or no, I can't. And so that's important. And Bayesian analysis is kind of its own bird, because this is where we throw in prior knowledge or prior distribution information that we have that can modify what we're looking at. So it's a little bit different bird altogether. So that's why we're going to cover that one separately. So let's really look then, focus down on EDA versus classical. And EDA is really looking at the graphical representation of data. We're looking for patterns to get insight about how is this data structured. Can we look and see different clusters? Can we see or test whether or not we can use classical stats or not? Or do we have to use some different distributions? Because maybe the distribution is not normal at all. Maybe the distribution is skewed highly to one way or another, and that changes the type of analyses you can use. So we're also looking for outliers and any data structures we can find. In classical, this usually assumes at that point that we have a normal distribution, meaning that it is uniformly distributed symmetrically, left and right about some kind of mean. And so that we can use the classical stats, your t-tests, your ANOVAs, your f-tests, your regression models that focus on that being a fundamental assumption. And so that is very powerful, yes, and we use it all the time because in many, many cases, you can use classical stats. However, you want to be sure that that's in fact the case. So this is where exploratory data analysis comes in. It allows us to apply some tests and also plotting so we can look at the patterns of the data to make sure that we can use classical stats or not. That's really kind of the main function in our application. So a couple things we have to assume for classical stats is we are randomly drawing the data. It's from a fixed distribution. The normal distribution is what we're assuming for classical stats. Again, if it's skewed or it's a Poisson or some other form of distribution, then we may not be able to do that. The distribution is located or fixed over time. Now, this is a difficulty because you may or may not know if that's true. So over the time that you are measuring the phenomenon, so in other words, the period of time depends upon what we're looking at. So if I'm trying to measure something and I'm assuming that what I'm measuring isn't changing over a period of time that I'm measuring it, then I would assume to get a distribution of different measures. Now, if my fundamental assumption of that average of the thing I'm measuring does shift in a period of time while I'm measuring it, well, that changes the game. Then we're looking at where we might have statistical process control, where we're seeing that mean shifting or we're seeing that range shifting. So that's where the distribution of the variability is fixed over time. So if they're not fixed, then you actually have to do a snapshot in time and then compare that with other snapshots in time, because then obviously their system is changing. So what's an example of this? Like if I'm measuring temperature in minutes, say in a facility, or humidity in a facility where I've got it fairly well controlled and I'm looking at that, it's probably safe to say that I can look at that over, you know, minutes, I can look at it over hours, I might even be able to look at it, you know, day to day to make sure it's not changing. But within that time period, I should expect to be somewhat under control and I'm trying to figure out what that value is. But if I was to be measuring temperature outside where we know there's variation throughout the day, then I would not expect that to give me the same type of data. Now, if I'm randomly sampling for every day, and maybe I'm doing it over a week in a certain season, that's a different question because now I'm looking at, well, what's my average daily temperature, knowing that I'm losing the dynamics of the change throughout the day. So that's where you have to get somewhat familiar with the data itself to know what types of questions you can ask and when you can use those types of things. But again, if I was to try to do that over months where the seasons are changing, well, then my whole average of the daily temperature is going to be shifting. So I know that system is changing through that time. So the amount of time and what you're trying to measure matters. So you have to have some understanding of how fast the system is that you're trying to measure, how fast it is changing. And are you taking samples within a time period where you wouldn't be able to detect that change, unless you're trying to detect that change, which is kind of what we do with certain type of stats. We're looking for, is there a change? A significant change, usually because we're trying to affect a system with a change in a variable. So maybe I change a setting on my machine and I want to see, does that change how precise I can manufacture, like say a diameter of a cylinder or something? And if I change this other variable, how does that affect my accuracy? So that's when we want to make sure that we're tightening things up so that we know that we're not adding other variables that could be changing our system, or at least being able to account for those variables. So that's kind of when we're talking about the fixed assumption mean. So of course, being fixed on the mean means that we're not changing the center point. And this is, so for example, here you see the black curve and you see the green curve. And of course, the center line obviously is shifting between those two. And the way we collect data is we collect enough data to know statistically that those means are changing. Now, this is oftentimes what we're looking for when we're talking about effects. This is what we do in medicine when we're looking for a statistically significant effect, is somebody takes medicine A, they have a certain ailment, and they have a measurable effect in the positive direction, right? We don't want to have bad side effects and going in the negative direction. So that's an example of where we're wanting to measure those effects, and we use classical stats for that. And then the other thing is a fixed variation. Now you can see on the red curve, that's actually obviously a much wider range where it's not a fixed variation. It's actually getting more variable versus the initial black curve. So those are the types of things we're looking at. So how do we test to make sure whether we can use classical stats or not? There's actually some classic tests that are recommended. And again, this comes directly from the National Institute of Standards of the United States, where there's four exploratory data analysis tests that are used for these assumptions. One is doing what we call a sequence plot. And another tool is called a lag plot or a chaos plot. We used to use this when looking at heart health, ironically. And just a little side note, in heart health, it's actually better to have a slightly chaotic heart rate constantly. That's a sign of a healthy heart. You actually have problems when the chaos starts going down to being the same target heart rate the whole time, which is kind of counterintuitive. Then a histogram. This allows us to plot counts versus subgroups of Y. And then a normal probability plot, which is ordered values of Y versus a theoretical ordered value of Y. So what we're going to be asking of all these plots is, do we have a process that's drifting? Is it unpredictable or out of control, or is it in control? This is what we're trying to figure out. And can we use a classical analysis? So this is kind of a plot of what things would look like. Now, what they all should look like if we were to pass these tests is normal randomness shows up. So if we look at the run sequence of plot Y, the first one, in the run sequence, in this first plot to the left, let me see if I can get my cursor over here. We're looking for, and notice we have a zero baseline, we're looking for an even distribution above and below. That's pretty much it. It's very similar to a statistical quality control curve to a center line, right? We want to have about an even distribution above and below in a run sequence. Now, lag plot should look like a random sample of dots, right? It should be roughly randomly distributed across the space. That's what we're looking for. That tells us it's not centrally changing to one space and over to another space. The histogram is what we're looking for, is something that's slightly roughly resembles a normal curve, right? It's bigger in the middle and falls down on each side. Doesn't have to be exact, but roughly that's what we're looking for. And so this histogram, you kind of see that. It's very centered around zero and it spreads out on either side. Not exactly, but that's okay. It doesn't have to. And a normal probability plot is you're looking for a fairly linear curve here where it looks somewhat like a line, and that's probably good enough. If all of these four are true, then absolutely you can use classical statistics, and that's really what it is. You look at all these plots, look at the patterns. If they pass, great. And usually this is easy enough to do with human visualization. to see it because we're really good at spotting these patterns. Now, when you don't pass all four of these are some examples of what it would look like. So a run sequence plot here, you actually, if you were to zoom in on this, you would see that it's actually jumping from some high values then down to some low values. And so it's almost bifurcating between values here. And so that would be a sign that, okay, this isn't quite one of those systems I can use classical stats that way. You also see a similar pattern in the lag plot, because now you see a very defined structure of where it's moving between different values. So it's in this almost chaotic orbit that's changing. Now this, depending upon how often you plot this, oftentimes it could be orbiting in one space around some center point, that we call that an attractor, but then it could also be shifting to another point. And so sometimes you'll see a loop going to another loop, and sometimes three loops, but it really just depends on what your system's doing. So that tells us that this is not something that would really work well with classical stats, because you really have at least more than one mean that you're targeting. That also shows up here in the histogram. So if you notice, it's actually lower in the middle and higher in two points. That tells me I have some what we call bimodal behavior. It's leaning toward this, and then over time it's moving toward another one. And then of course in the normal probability plot, you get more of an S-curve shape, a little less of a line in there. And so that's what we're looking for when you run these classical stats. To get some practice at this, in class we'll run through a little data set that we can download, that we've got data sets from NIST. So these are great because these are data sets where we kind of know the outcomes, so you get practice in building out your exploratory data analysis plots. And so here you can actually build each one of these plots, and that's exactly what we're going to do in class. So we're going to build a sequence plot, build a lag plot, histogram plot, and the normal probability plot, which takes a little bit longer. I've actually put a link to an Excel tutorial to do that as well. So, and this is actually something I want to do as an exercise with everybody in class, but this is a great way to do it. And again, if you're watching this online, go to the NIST.gov sites. This is actually where the data sets are, but they actually give you instructions on every one of these plots and how to do it. The first three aren't too complicated to do. It's the last one that takes a little bit more time and effort to do. So that's why I put the tutorial up there. Now, assuming we pass all that stuff, we can actually use classical stats. And if you've had a basic stats class, you know exactly kind of what that entails. It also allows us to do statistical quality control, which is under here. We can evaluate our processes. We can do service quality. We can look at productivity levels. This is where we use a lot of our scientific method and research, making those assumptions. So it opens us to a whole bunch of different areas of analysis that we can make some assumptions, which also means that when we see these changes, we can detect these changes knowingly, right? Because if the assumption is if we don't change anything and we're measuring our system, let's say we're measuring width of something, doesn't matter what it is, then we'd expect our black curve with that target width, in this case at 10, we'll say centimeters, doesn't matter. But if we input a variable that we want to see if it has an effect on the system, and so we impose a change on the system, we're tweaking that system, we're perturbing that system in a known way, then let's say we get the green curve, then we know this is where we can do those tests of statistical significance that something has changed because we changed an input, right? And oftentimes, particularly in scientific experiments, we will do a one-to-one change. We'll shift something in our input variables to our system, and then we measure something that we should know as a control. So we need the control situation, which is the black curve, and then we also need the curve where we may change something. Now, whether it's actually changed or not, this is where we usually have our confidence intervals. Classically, the baseline 95% confidence interval is usually the minimum to declare something has a statistical significance. Now, the more critical, or the more, I guess, people want to have higher and higher confidence in this, like in physics or in psychotherapy or something like that, or even in medicine, they may want to have a higher level. So instead of 95%, they say you want a 99% or 99.9%. Or in physics, for them to even declare like new particles or something, it's usually like one in a million. So it's 99.9999%. You get the idea. So the test gets tighter and tighter. And so this is where we use the p-values to measure whether or not we have an actual statistical change. So if we use 95%, then the p-value is really that remaining 5%. So the p-value has to be less than that for our critical value. And then F-tests. F-tests tell us, instead of that shift in the mean, it tells us the shift in variance, right? So that would tell us, do we have our black curve, which is our control curve, or we perturb something and now we see a change in our variance. So then we get this red curve, meaning it's made something more variable versus less variable, right? So, and that may have consequences in either direction. So, and this is where we compare something called the F value to an F critical value. And again, typical starting point is 95% to detect these changes. And that's really where we use that. So when you dive into your classical stats, you learn about all these, right, with t-tests, f-tests. But this is why it works, is because of those assumptions we've already made through EDA. Last but not least, I'm just touching Bayesian analysis here. We are going to do a full unit on Bayesian analysis. But what's really cool about it, and I just want to pique your interest here, is when we talk about Bayesian analysis, all the other previous types of analysis we've discussed assumes that we don't know anything about the system, at least in a way that we're using it for our analysis. Let's put it that way. When we get to Bayesian analysis, we actually get to use previous information that we know, or maybe we did some experience and then we know some information, so that then changes our assumptions for the next analysis. So I'm holding that off for later, so it'll be fun when we get to it. I hope you enjoyed this conversation, and I'll see you next time in class. Take care.